I'm Bob Rich, Executive Director of Placer Arts. Placer Arts is the Arts Council of Placer County, and our mission is to be a catalyst for the arts and humanities throughout Placer County, to encourage the arts, bring programs and classes and education throughout the county, and stimulate the quality of life.
Welcome. I'm pleased to be here today. My name is Gia McNutt, and I'm one of the 77 artists on the Placer Art Studio Tour this year. And we're going to be visiting with a few artists every week and sharing that with you so you can get a taste of what this tour is all about. With me today, I've got Teresa Swerdlow and Rick Watson. And I'd like to start by having Rick tell us what kind of art you create, and is this your first time on the tour?
This is my second time on the tour. I do oil painting mostly, and a lot of it is done outside. Enjoy being outside, painting, seeing the colors and everything there is to see in nature. This is an example of one of the ones that I've done recently. Just a very unusual, maybe, because it's not just typical landscape, but it was an interesting subject and decided to paint it quickly. But I enjoy painting, I enjoy colors, and enjoy being outside. I also do abstract painting in the studio, mostly.
Great, thank you, Rick. Teresa, your art is definitely different than Rick and my art. So tell us a little bit about your art and your studio tour experience.
So this is my second year also on the tour. I'm a fused glass artist, and my work is very eclectic and dynamic. Glass is such a great medium to work with because the colors are so vibrant, and you have choices between translucence and opacity, and you can really get a lot of different effects. Some of my work is abstract, such as the plate there. Some of my work is more representative. I do enamel painting on glass, which gives me the option to do imagery. So there's a lot of versatility in my work and a lot of different flavors.
Awesome. I love your work. The fused glass stuff is so it makes me want to do it. So
that's what happened to me too.
Yeah, and just to talk briefly about my work, I'm Gia McNutt, and I mostly do acrylics. I also do some mixed media. The picture that we have here today, the painting, is fairly representative of my work. I like brilliant colors. I like doing landscapes. I often like doing people in landscapes. And I'm also experimenting with some abstract things as well. So, well, I would like to pose another question to each of you. How important is color in your work, and how do you select the colors that you put into a particular piece?
Do you want to start, Rick?
Go ahead.
So color, obviously, with glass is extra important because the glass reflects light and it sort of gives off its own sort of glow. And so I consider all of the rules of color and then I break them. That's sort of how I create my work. I think about the cools and the hots and all of the theories about color that we are taught in art school. And then I think, okay, but I really like this. And then that's sort of, I make a combination of what I know I'm supposed to do and what I really like.
Cool. How about you, Rick?
Well, there is beauty everywhere. And I try to capture that with color. And so sometimes they go a little brighter or a little darker than what you really would see out there, mainly because it's important that you capture the image in the best way you can. And color and values are the way to do that. So my yellows are maybe a little brighter than you see grass or something, or my reds maybe a little redder. That's okay. That's what I'm looking for. It's so easy. We're so inundated with images that we don't catch everything anymore. We just kind of glaze over it. So something that stands out maybe catches our attention a little bit quicker. Color is a great way to do that.
I love your answer. I very much like to use brilliant colors and colors that may be a little more brilliant than the colors that I saw that day. But not, you know, one might argue, you know, there was that pink and that purple in the sky and that sunset. There really was. But I like the contrast, and I like dramatic. So I like to use color in that way also. Another question that I've been wanting to pose to you is, and for you as well, but how do you come up with your subject matter? How do you decide what you want to create next?
Well, it's whatever grabs me. You know, if it's abstract, there's a lot of different ways I get abstract. Lots of times it's sitting around killing time with working on my iPad, and I pull it out, grab one of the programs that's on there, and start doing an image. Eventually, if I like it, it becomes an oil painting. The oil painting is always a little bit different than what I did on the iPad, but that's okay. That's part of the creative process. When I'm doing plein air or painting outside, then much of what I do is just whatever grabs me when I'm looking. In the one I have here, I had already painted a painting that day of a subject I had been researching and looking at, and had completed that painting. Still had some time, the light was good. I just said, well, what can I paint? Well, I can look across the highway here. No, nothing really over there. Well, there's our cars are right here. Unusual subject, but it works. So quickly put that together, and it's been a pretty popular painting. So it's sometimes the subject grabs you instead of you grabbing the subject.
I can appreciate that. Yeah. How about you, Teresa?
I work very similarly. I see different things throughout my life, and certain things appeal to me and stick in my head, and I start thinking, oh, I could paint that, and then I could turn it into this, and then I could make it look like that. And once I get an idea, it starts rolling around, and then it comes out in my work.
Well, I didn't really answer the question yet, but I want to ask a different question right now. Have you ever been told by a gallery or an art critic or anyone in a position to accept your work that you should limit your style to a certain genre that would be recognizable as your art? And did you take that advice?
I've been given that advice recently and I totally ignored it. I'm a pretty eclectic person. I have a lot of different interests. Sometimes I do really traditional work, and sometimes I do really crazy out there work, and they all appeal to me. And so that comes out in the work that I do. It's what I like, and so it's what I create.
I think that's one of the rules that as artists we break, like most of the other rules. I've been told that, but sometimes I take that as a compliment, you know? You can do lots of different things. And I like to do that. If I wanted to do just one thing, I'd work on an assembly line someplace and just do one thing. I don't want to do that. I want to be creative, passionately creative. And that means I'm going to do different things at different times. Sometimes they're going to be abstract. Sometimes they're going to be impressionistic. Sometimes they're going to be maybe a little more realistic. But it's going to be loose. It's going to be what works. That's part of the creative process.
Yeah, so I've been told that. And being a newer artist, I've been doing art for, I don't know, between 3 and 4 years. I took that to heart because, you know, I'm in the learning mode. And I think that it has affected my choice of subjects because I felt like I should try to, you know, create a specific genre of work that somehow was cohesive. But I've been deciding to break away from that because I love sunsets. I love reflection of light on water. Those are wonderful things. But I love many other things as well. So decided that I didn't want to be limited by that.
Sure.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, but at the same time, sometimes you get into a mode where right now I just completed a series on rain. Okay, I did a series, several different things, different ways. And so in that way, each one is different, but they have the same theme.
Yeah, that's a very smart way to do it. And I thought through that as well as a way to be cohesive and yet have different mm-hmm. things happening. Mm-hmm. So I would love to know, how long have you been doing art?
Well, when I was in kindergarten, that was a few years ago. One of the first things I remember doing was finger painting. And the color of finger painting just attracted me. I just thought how fun that is to be able to take a red and a blue and a yellow or a green or whatever and play with my fingers and create something, some kind of a mess. It was fun. And then another thing that I learned in kindergarten was, back in the day, you took crayons and you would color your crayon with all red and then black on top of that and then blue on top of that and then green on top of that and take your fingernail and scrape it out and make an image. That was the beginning of art for me. Mm. It really was. And so I've done art on and off in various ways throughout my life. Probably about 12 years ago, I got serious about it. And so now I do it full time.
Great.
Yeah. My story is similar to Rick. My parents were both artists. Oh. And they didn't give us coloring books. They gave us blank paper. Mm-hmm. And so I've always drawn and colored and created. And my mom taught me to sew by giving me a piece of fabric and saying, here, make something. So I have always been a creator. I started working in glass about 4 years ago, and it just got me. It's the color and what you can do with it, and you can make these actual palpable things. You can make bowls and plates, mm-hmm. and you know, it just has this solidness to it. I just love it.
And I love the functional art that you make. Yeah. I got to see some of it at the High Hand Gallery the other day. And it's beautiful. It makes me want to have sushi on that little sushi plate. So actually, just like you, my mom was an artist. And so I grew up doing all kinds of art. In fact, she told us when we had a coloring book, color outside the lines. Teachers didn't like that, but I insisted. But I really didn't turn to visual art until a few years ago. I did performing arts instead, and now I also sing. But 3-4 years ago, I got into visual art and then became very serious about that. Speaking of that, we do have artists of all experience levels. Some some of the artists have been on the tour for the entire 23 years. And then some other artists, this is their first time on the tour. So there's a lot of diversity. One of the things that's coming up that we'd like to invite the public to is the preview show at the General Gomez Gallery. The show will be running November 4th through November 17th, and will feature a piece from every artist on the tour. So it's a great place. They call it the Taste of the Tour reception. It's a great place to check out and plan your tour as you're deciding who are you going to go visit, or decide that you're going to take all 3 days and visit all 77. I've seen some people who actually have done that. But I'm curious if you have selected your piece that you're going to submit for the preview show yet, and if so, what it is. I'll just go ahead and say that I have not selected yet, so I'm hoping to complete one that I'm working on now. We were talking about it before this.
Right.
And I'm hoping I'll be able to submit that, but we'll see.
I have one piece in mind. I'm thinking that might be the piece, but there's still a little bit of time before we have to commit. So we'll see what comes out of the kiln in the next couple of weeks.
Very good.
I have one I had selected, and I think it's not the one I'm going to use. There's one I'm trying to finish, one I started about a year ago. It's a wharf scene, but it's mostly just junk. again, kind of unusual. And I'm just trying to get it finished up and get it to look right. And I'm getting close. I think it's about there. So if I get it finished up, it'll be at the Gomez.
Great. Yeah, we are going to have a reception November 4th from 5 to 8 p.m. And the public is invited to the reception. And again, it's a great place to start to plan your tour. See, some other things that I just want to mention about the tour. Many artists will be demonstrating in their studios. Are you planning on demonstrating?
I am.
Yeah?
Yeah. We recently had a showing, and I did a piece during the day. It's fun to do, but also I enjoy talking to people, too. Mm-hmm. So I will be attempting to do a demo.
Okay.
Each day.
Yep.
I'll be showing at Gallery IQ in Rockland with two other artists, and they're both painters. They're going to be demoing. Glass is too hard to demo.
Yeah.
But I do have videos playing of me in the process, so people will be able to see how I create my work. And we're dreaming up a little hands-on experience for visitors at our location also.
And that's fun. Do you have any more to share about some of the ideas about the hands-on experience?
We're going to keep that as a surprise as it develops, but we're hoping to have something that people can come and participate in.
Mm-hmm. Very good. And what studio location on the tour map are you?
On the map, we're number 68, and we are at the corner of Midas and Pacific in Rockland at Gallery IQ.
Gotcha. And Rick, where are you located?
Newcastle Packing Shed. It's number 40, and we're just off Highway 80 in Newcastle.
Great. And I'm also showing with Rick at the Newcastle Packing Shed's Art Studios and Gallery. My number is 39, so at Newcastle Packing Sheds, we have 39 and 40. And I think we are going to come up with a hands-on experience. We did it last year. It was pretty fun. And I think it's a great thing to give somebody, you know, kids and people, something to do when they come. Mm-hmm. So let's see. I just want to mention some of the other artists on the tour. Just drop a few names. But we've got Janet and Rick Nicholson, who are well known for their blown glass creations. We have Patty Pirapandong, who's known for many different mediums, oil and pastel being amongst them. We've got Maya Lowe, an acrylic artist out of Granite Bay. And there are just so many artists, great artists. I welcome you to mention a couple of the artists and what they do.
Well, let's see.
We can mention Jeannie
I'll
to start with.
I'll be with Jeannie Kreps and Connie Rodriguez. They're both award-winning painters and art instructors. And their work is really amazing and also pretty diverse. So we're a pretty good stop to see a variety of work. And then my dear friend Ritu Atwal will be showing in Granite Bay. And I don't know her number, but she's showing in her home studio. Okay. And her work is just lovely.
Wonderful.
Craig Johnson is also going to be showing in Granite Bay. He's a photographer, does excellent work.
Definitely,
definitely. Definitely someone to check out.
There's also, there are a few locations where there are multiple artists grouped together. Mm-hmm. You've just mentioned Gallery IQ, that's one of them. Newcastle Packing Shed, Art Studios and Galleries, another. The OLAS, the old library in Auburn. It's now a studio, and it features several artists on the tour.
Sure.
I'm going to attempt to name them.
Sandy Delahanty.
Sandy Delahanty. We've got Tien Dao, who does many different types of sculptures and
beautiful work.
Beautiful work.
Paula Amerine.
Thank you, Paula Amerine, who is known for a lot of her artwork surrounding produce and these type of things. Some of these pieces are actually, I think people may know those pieces. I know there's a couple other artists there, but there are many studios that feature multiple artists. Paul Harmon is a pastel artist. He's out of Auburn.
So tell people where they can find more information about the
location. That's a great idea. So we have many ways that people can get more information. One of the ways is to go to plasterarts.org. You can get a studio tour guide there directly. as well as more information about the preview show that will be November 4th through the 17th with the reception from 5 to 8 p.m. on the 4th. I know there are some locations that people are going to be able to pick up those studio tour guides.
We will have guidebooks at Gallery IQ. I know that there's also going to be a link on the internet to the map. And you can also check Facebook. We've got a Facebook page specifically for the tour. If you just search Placer Arts, you'll find it. It has the Leaf logo. And we'll have a link to the map on there, as well as bios and samples of artwork from all 77 artists.
Yeah, that is a really great thing to note. So if you go to the website, you will be able to look at biography as well as images of each artist's work. Some of the artists as well have their own websites. If you're interested, you can find those, or it will probably be listed in the bio. And then also on the Placer Arts website, there is actually an artist directory as well. And many of the artists probably have their work, many pieces of their work, in that Placer Arts artist directory.
Right.
So, gosh, let's see. What else should we talk about? Perhaps, there are giveaways. That's something good to know. Most of the studios and galleries that are participating in this will have some sort of drawing or giveaway for you to participate in when you come to their studio.
Right.
Other than that, I just really want to promote that this is a wonderful opportunity to see a lot of different artists in their studios doing demonstrations, showing their work. It is getting close to the holiday gift-giving season, so it's a great opportunity not only to add to your own art collection, but it's also a great opportunity to acquire some art as a gift for a loved one. So with that, we would just like to invite everyone to come join us at the preview show as well as on the studio tour and see as many artists as you can.
I'd like to invite you to join us for the 23rd Annual Placer Arts Studios Tour coming up November 11th through 13th. 77 artists in 40 locations from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. The artists will be in their workshops or other areas and studios showcasing their work and demonstrating what they do. We have artists doing visual arts, painting, ceramics, photography, woodwork, and much, much more. We invite you to join us again November 11th through 13th from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. and hopefully you'll find some pieces to take home with you.